بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
And then he brings some of the hadiths, like the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah has 99 names, 100 except one. He who encompasses them will enter paradise. And this is agreed upon, but there is another hadith, another narration, in which names are enlisted. Those names are listed, which is a weak hadith actually. But the scholars derived a similar number from Quran and Sunnah. They derived them and they counted them up to 99 names. Now, of course, these are not the only names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his dua, he said, Oh Allah, I ask you by your names, which you have taught whomever you wished from your creatures. And then he said, in the same dua, he said, and by those names which have been kept secret, hidden by you. So there are names which have not been known to anyone, even to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also in another true hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ describes the Day of Judgment when he is prostrating under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. While waiting in prostration, he would be praising Allah with names and attributes which are inspired then to the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ says, I remain prostrating and glorifying Allah with names and attributes that are inspired to me at that time, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders him to raise his head and ask. And then he mentions the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, the same thing that we mentioned just now. And every name of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala involves an attribute, because every name has a meaning, and that meaning is the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the name Al-Alim means that Allah is the most knowledgeable, and Al-Hakim means that Allah is the most wise. It includes the meaning of wisdom in it. As-Sami' includes the meaning of hearing, and Al-Basir includes the meaning of seeing, and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. These are all names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this surah, we see that first Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala denies all deficiencies by saying قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. No deficiency whatsoever should be attributed to Allah, because He is the only one who has no deficiency. And then اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ. الصَّمَدُ means the one with all the good qualities, the good attributes. So first denying all the deficiencies and then approving all the good qualities. This is the way of Tawheed Asma'u Sifat. just like saying الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. This is first denying that there is any deficiency, then الحي القيوم, الحي القيوم, proving his, some of his good qualities. Similarly, ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. Nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is denying all deficiencies. وهو السميع العليم. This is approving the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, السميع العليم. So this is the way of Quran also, that the negation and approval are combined each time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his names and attributes. He combines between negating all deficiencies, denying all deficiencies, and approving all qualities. So just like in Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, we have two pillars. One is composed of denial, and the second is composed of approval. The same in Tawheed al-Asma al-Sifat, we have two pillars, denial and approval. And denial always comes first, because you have to clear the path for what you want to approve. So you have to clear the path. Make the heart first empty of any false beliefs about Allah. Then put the right belief. Just like if you want to keep a pure honey, keep it pure, you cannot put it in a dirty pot. So first tahliya, then tahliya. These are the Arabic words. Tahliya means to empty, to clean, to clear the path. Tahliya means to sweeten. So if you want to sweeten your heart with the attributes of Allah, first clean your heart from any distortions, from any shirk, from any bad thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't clarify the path, there is no good of putting the truth. It will not be a pure truth. It will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have bad thinkings about the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart, doubts, whatever, you cannot put the sweetness of this name that involves that Allah is the most just. So this is Tawheed al-Asma wa-Sifat and how it should be believed in. Then the Shaykh quotes the hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, that a man from the Ansar was leading them in prayer in Masjid Quba, and whenever he started a surah, he would read it in prayer, and he would read قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ in every rak'ah, in every rak'ah, in every unit in salat, and then he reads some other Quran with it. So his companions thought that he might be doing something against the sunnah. Of course, they were very careful not to worship Allah with anything which might not be according to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were very concerned, even though the man was only reciting Quran, and he was reciting the best surah, or one of the best surahs in Quran, which is one third of Quran in meaning, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, because it involves tawheed only. And despite that, their emotions about this surah did not lead them to just be passive about whatever occurs. They went and asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam about the action of this man. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam approved of it, they accepted it, because it becomes a sunnah. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam approves it, it becomes a sunnah. So this is the way the Muslim should be actually in regarding to any action in prayer or any other worship. You have to be very careful. You just don't do things which you are not sure that there is a proof for it in Quran and Sunnah. so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked this man, what made you read it every rak'ah? He said, oh Messenger of Allah, I love it. Because this surah involves tawheed, and who does not love tawheed? So he said, because, oh Messenger of Allah, I love it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged him, saying, your loving for this surah will make you enter paradise. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not blame him. He did not say any harsh thing to him, because he was doing something right, and because his intention was very good and he loved this great surah. Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned also the same story. And in this narration, when the man was asked, why is he doing this? He said, because it has the attributes of the most merciful. Because it has the attributes of the most merciful. And this narration is also in Sahih al-Bukhari. Despite that, Ibn Hazm denied it, because the way of Ibn Hazm, even though he was a great scholar, and he, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah has praised him in a lot of issues of aqidah in regards to faith and qadr and faith, matters of faith, iman, he praised him. But in this issue, unfortunately, he followed the way of Jahm ibn Safwan, that is the total denial of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he went to the extreme, that is not to say that Allah has attributes. That's why he said this narration is weak, because the man says Allah has attributes. He says, I love the surah because it contains the attributes of the All-Merciful. So Ibn Hazm said this narration is weak, and he fabricated some reason for it, but this narration is agreed upon by all Muslim scholars. And if he denies this narration, what would he do with the verse? Not only these verses that declare clearly that Allah has names, but other verses which declare clearly that Allah has attributes, like the verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. Glory be to your Lord from all the false descriptions or the false qualities that they attribute to him. So this is a clear reply on Ibn Hazm, who says that the hadith is weak. What is he going to do with this verse? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the attributes here, saying yasifun. Yasifun is the verb from sifat. Sifat are attributes, and yasifun means they describe him with attributes. And yani, this claim of Ibn Hazm is indeed false. And it's not only this issue that he denied a true hadith, but even in another issue regarding singing, he denied a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, because it's against his madhab of allowing singing and music and a lot of other things. And in this regard, he was lenient and he was allowing all this. But that is also because of his crooked way in fiqh, because his way of fiqh was not approved of by scholars of Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. He went in the way of Zahiriyyah, Zahiri, which means to go literally all the time, literally, without thinking of the meanings. If the Prophet ﷺ says something, then you cannot think why he ordered us to do this, for what reason. For example, we were ordered to throw out the water that the dog has licked its tongue in or put its mouth in. Ibn Hazm's madhab is There is no reason. No one should think of any reason. In all hadiths, in all orders, this is madhab al-zahiriyya. And this is not the way of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah say, indeed, there are some orders which we do not understand why we should do this, but we do it out of worshipping Allah. Like going around the Kaaba 7 times. Why not 8? Why not 9? Why not 5? Like throwing 7 pebbles at the symbol of the devil. Why not 6? Why not 8? Why not 9? These are orders which we call ta'abudi. We do them for the sake of worshipping Allah. Just like Umar said, radiallahu anhu, when he kissed the black stone, he said, I know that there is no harm and benefit in you. And if it was not for the fact that I saw the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do it, I would not do it. So these are things which are ta'abudi. But most of the orders and most of the things which are forbidden are not ta'abudi. They are for a reason. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam orders something, that's why Ahl al-Sunnah have qiyas, analogy. Zahiriyah don't have qiyas. Because Qiyas's main pillar is to know the illah, the reason why the Prophet ordered, why he forbid. If you don't have the illah, you cannot make Qiyas. And Qiyas is one of the pillars of the usul of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. We have Kitab, Quran, Sunnah, Ijma', consensus, and Qiyas. So Zahiriyya do not have Qiyas. And therefore, their fiqh يعني, can be funny in many situations, actually, in many situations. For example, Ibn Hazm's madhab is that if you urinate directly in a pot which has some water in it, then this becomes najis. This should be thrown out, okay? He doesn't say it becomes najis. But if you urinate in a pot and then throw it into that water, that's different, he says. That's different. It doesn't, you don't throw it out. You make wudu in it, you use it, whatever. So this is, of course, a crooked madhab. Anyway, Ibn Hazm, despite what we mentioned about him and names and attributes of Allah, he's a great Sunni scholar, and this is a deviation that he has fallen into, but that should not be a cause of abandoning him altogether. This is the way of Ahlul Ghulu, the people of exaggeration, who abandon the Sunni scholar for some mistakes that he has done. The Sunni scholars praise Ibn Hazm and they benefit from his writings and they consider him a respectful Sunni scholar. Then the Shaykh mentions some verses regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, the verse which has the attribute of the face for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the verses which prove of the attributes of the hands of Allah, and all other verses regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. The topic today, inshallah, is a continuation. The first point, the Shaykh says, that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah approve of the names of Allah and His attributes as they are mentioned in Quran and Sunnah, and as the apparent meaning is, على ظاهرها. ظاهر means what appears, the apparent meaning. As Imam Shafi'i رحمه الله made it clear when he said, آمنت بالله وبما جاء عن الله على مراد الله. وآمنت برسول الله وبما جاء عن رسول الله على مراد رسول الله. I believe in Allah and in all that which came from Allah
in the meaning which Allah meant. And I believe in the Messenger of Allah. And all that which has come with the Messenger of Allah in the meaning that the Messenger meant. This is the best clarification. Why did Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah said in the meaning that Allah meant, in the meaning that the Messenger meant? To cut any kind of altering with the meanings or false imaginations, like those who say the hand of Allah does not mean hand, it means such and such. The face of Allah does not mean face, it is such and such. As a matter of fact, even the mercy, they don't approve of the attribute of mercy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a true mercy. And they say mercy means Allah's intention to reward, Allah's intention to be good, things like that. Or they say it is allegorical. The mercy is allegorical. It's not the true meaning. And when you ask them why, they say because mercy is a softness in the heart. And we cannot attribute that to Allah. And the reason why they are falling into this, because the first thing which occurred to their minds was resembling Allah to His creatures. Otherwise, they would not say such foolishness. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Himself, He is merciful, then that kind of mercy is a true mercy which suits His glory and His essence. Why should anyone compare it to the mercy that is in the humans or in the animals or whatever? This is haram, no comparison. So this rule of zahir in attributes, zahir means the apparent meaning. This is a must. This is an obligation. But zahir does not mean that we resemble Allah's attributes to our attributes. As a matter of fact, this contradicts zahir. Because the apparent meaning of any attribute in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like that of any of His creatures. This is the apparent meaning. As a matter of fact, between creatures themselves, the apparent meaning of hand for a man is not like the apparent meaning of a hand for an ant. And everyone knows this. And even though both are creatures, and yet when someone says the hand of such and such person, what occurs to his mind is not that when he hears the hand of an elephant or the hand of an ant, what occurs to his mind, the apparent meaning, is not the same. So if it's not the same when we are speaking about creatures, then how about speaking about the Creator who has no like and no equal and no rival? So no one would equal the meanings of the attribute of Allah to the meaning of the attribute of the human, for example, or any creature, except someone who is either out of his sanity, he's insane, or he is someone who has been saturated with innovations of altering the meanings and changing the meanings and so on. The second point, the Shaykh says, Ahlul Sunnah deny any resemblance between the attributes of the creatures and the attributes of Allah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it clearly in His book, there is nothing like Him. Nothing is like unto Him. Yet He is all hearing, all seeing. So this is the way of Ahl Sunnah. And this verse, which the Sheikh mentions here, includes a lot of beautiful rules regarding the way of Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. First is that Tawheed al-Asma wa-Sifat, this kind of Tawheed of believing in the right way regarding the names and attributes of Allah, constituted of two things. First, negation, and second, affirmation. Just like Tawheed al-Ibadah, just like the Tawheed of worship of Allah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha is a negation, illallah is an affirmation. Similarly here, Laysa kamithlihi shay is a negation. وهو السميع البصير is an affirmation. And the second point is that the negation precedes. Why? Because you cannot affirm something, approve of something on the basis of distortions in your heart about Allah. You have to have the right ground for your affirmation. Your heart has to be cleared of any misconceptions about Allah in order for you to accept the true meaning of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third point, the Sheikh says, the third point, that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah do not exceed what is in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that which Allah attributes for himself and that which the Messenger attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they attribute to Allah. And that which Allah negates about himself or denies about himself, like injustice, for example, and so on, any kind of deficiency, or anything which the Messenger denies about Allah and negates about Allah, then we also follow in that negation. So we follow not only in approval, but similarly in negation, in denial. And whatever Allah keeps quiet about, does not mention, and whatever the Messenger keeps quiet about and does not mention, we keep quiet and do not mention. Therefore, it is not the way of Ahl Sunnah to say that Allah is not a body. Why? Simply because Allah did not say about himself in Quran that he is not a body. He did not deny about himself. But can Ahl Sunnah say that Allah is a body? No, they cannot say that. Because Allah did not say, I am a body, or I have a body. And the Messenger did not say, Allah has a body, or he is a body. This is the way of Ahl Sunnah. This is when it comes to the word itself, body. But when it comes to the meaning of that word, body, then we ask this person who says Allah is not a body, we ask him, what do you mean by this? If he says, I mean that Allah has no hands, he has no face, and so on, we say, no, what you're saying, what you're meaning is totally false. Allah has two hands, and he has two eyes, and he has a face. Even though we don't say that he's a body, but he has two hands, he has a face, he has two eyes, as he mentioned in his book, and as his messenger mentioned about him. And if this person says, what I mean by this is that Allah is not like us, is not like his creatures. He has hands, but not like our hands. He has a face, but not like our faces. We say, yeah. The meaning here is true. But why are you saying that he is not a body? You should not say this word. Even though the meaning implied is true, you should not say anything about Allah which he did not say about himself. Why don't you express this true meaning that Allah has two hands, not like his creature's hands, and so on? Why don't you express it in the way that Allah expressed it, instead of this innovative way of expressing it? Therefore, this is what the Sheikh here means. And then the fourth point, the Sheikh says that Ahlul Sunnah believe that when it comes to verses in Quran or Hadith, through Hadith, regarding the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all these are considered to be muhkam, which means have one clear set meaning. It is not probable of having two meanings, three meanings. No. One set, clear, and definitive meaning. One clear, definitive meaning. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about himself that he is merciful, then he is merciful. And the Arabs know what the meaning of mercy is. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he ascended his throne, Allah has ascended his throne. That's it. One meaning. That is, he rose upon it. That is, he become over it. There is no other meaning. That is why Imam Malik rahimahullah, when he was asked about this verse, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa, kayfa istawa, the Lord, the most beneficent, has risen upon his throne. The innovator said, how did he rise? So Imam Malik said, al-istiwa'u ghayru majhul. The meaning of rising upon the throne is not something unknown. It is not. When the Arabs say someone rises upon something, they have a set meaning, they have a definitive meaning, that is, he becomes over it and settles on it. This is the meaning. So, this is the only way that we go by, that is the apparent meaning that the Arabs used to use, because Quran was sent down in the language of Quraysh, who were yani, the clearest in the Arabic language. So it is not from the irrelevant or mutashabah or probable. No, it is from the muhkam, the set, the definitive. Anyone who says that the verses of sifat is from mutashabah, he is definitely saying something which has no proof at all. As a matter of fact, the proofs are against this. How could the verses about tawheed be probable and not clear? Who can say this about the book of Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about his book that it is clear, it is easy to understand. So how could the main topic, the main issue in Quran be expressed to us in an unclear way? This is actually a slander against Quran. It is nothing but a slander against Quran to say that Quran is not clear. And this is, unfortunately, the way of Ash'ariyya, Maturidiyya, those groups who claim that the verses of Sifat and the Hadiths of Sifat are mutashabah. They are unclear. They are not set. They are not definitive. As a matter of fact, they went to the extreme of saying that these verses and Hadiths, if they are taken literally, then this is great kufr. As-Sanusi has mentioned something like this in his book, he's Ash'ari. And the explainer of the book says, the foundations of kufr are six. And then he mentions the sixth foundation. And that is, he says, to take those verses of sifat, of attributes of Allah, literally. This is one of the fundamentals of kufr to them. You see? And to the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, this is one of the fundamentals of faith. Not only one of the fundamentals of faith, but one of the fundamentals of tawheed, which is the essence of faith, which is the first important fundamental. So you can see the difference between Ahlul Sunnah and the innovator. The fifth point, the Sheikh says, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah make tafweel regarding how the attributes are. Tafweel means to say that Allah knows how His hands are. We don't know. This is tafweel. Tafweel is to give up explaining the details. This is tafweel. This is the way of Ahl-Sunnah. But the way of Ash'ariyya and Maturidiyya, at least part of them, is to do this to the meaning, not to the details of how, but to the meaning, which is definitely wrong. To do it to the meaning is a slander against Quran. Because when you do it to the meaning, you are saying that hundreds of verses of Quran have no meaning. We don't know what they mean. And not only that, but verses which are mentioned over and over and over and over, and words which are mentioned almost at every verse, at the end of every verse or every other verse, attributes of Allah are mentioned. So tafweel in the wrong sense is a big innovation. It is worse than altering the meaning. It is worse than changing the meaning. Why? Because it is a slander, a big slander against the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says about Ayatul Kursi, which is a verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 255, that this is the greatest verse in Quran. And those people claim that this verse has no meaning. Al-Hayy, Al-Qayyum, La ta'khudhu sinatun wa la nawm, and so on, all attributes of Allah. They say no, it has no meaning. So this is a great slander against the Book of Allah. But this is not a direct slander. A direct slander is when you say something nasty or ugly and you mean it, then this is kufr, great kufr. But what those people are doing, they are saying statements which lead to slander. That's why Ahl-Sunnah don't declare them as kafirs. They don't declare Ash'aris and Maturidis as kafirs. They declare them as Muslims, but innovators. The Sheikh says, the reply on those who deny the names and attributes, or deny partially, because denial is of two kinds. One is the way of a person called Jahm ibn Safwan, who was killed and crucified because of his kufr, denial of all attributes of Allah. The prince of Khurasan killed him and crucified him. And he told him, if you were to hide in my own stomach, I would open my stomach and kill you. Even though this prince of Khurasan was a common man, but he was a Muslim and he had a great jealousy about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and about Tawheed. So he told him, by Allah, if you were to hide in my own stomach, I would open it and take you out and kill you. This is Jahm. And his Sheikh Ja'd, Al-Ja'd ibn Dirham, who was killed on Eid Day by another prince, the prince of Iraq, Khalid ibn Abdullah al-Qusari, who pulled him on Eid Day like a sheep. And he came in front of the Muslims, in front of the scholars. The scholars were tabi'is, the students of companions. And he took Ja'd like a sheep. He slaughtered him. And he told the Muslims, go ahead, make your sacrifice. For my sacrifice is Al-Ja'd ibn Dirham today. Because he says Allah does not love and Allah does not have hands. The meaning of that. And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in his poetry An-Nuniyah, he said Allah has praised the action of Khalid, and every believer praises the action of Khalid. Why? Because this kafir, al-ja'd, is slandering Allah by denying his attributes. What kind of God is the one who does not love? If he does not love, then he does not hate. Then everything is equal to him. Kufr and faith, kufr and Islam is the same, because he has no love, he has no hate. Then whether you are in prostration for him or you are committing fornication, is the same to him, because he has no love, he has no hate. So anyway, the Sheikh starts by saying that the first group, Al-Jahmiyyah, whom we just mentioned, for the followers of Jahm, and they deny all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila is from I'tizal, seclusion. And they were called by this name because their head secluded himself from the circle of Al-Hasan al-Basri, a great student of the companions, a great tabi'i. He secluded himself because his faith about Allah was different, about Allah's attributes, and his faith about sinners was different, because he considered any sinner to be out of Islam. The Mu'tazila did not dare to say that any sinner is a kafir, like Khawarij, but they dared to say he is out of Islam. And they dared to say that he'll be in hellfire forever. But in dunya, they said, we don't say he's a kafir. We say he's out of Islam, but he is not a kafir. So they were asked, if he is out of Islam, where else could he go? They said, there is a position in between. And this is the main distinction of Al-Mu'tazila. This position, the position in between, manzila bayna al-manzilatayn. Anyway, the Mu'tazilas were contradictory. That's why the scholars like Shaykh al-Islam calls Jahmiyyah the males and calls Mu'tazila the females. Why? Because Jahmiyyah gave it to you straight in the face. Allah has no attributes, no names. Mu'tazila said, no. We must say Allah is all hearing. We must say Allah has this name. But we cannot say he has a hearing. See, so he is the all hearing by name with no hearing by meaning. The all seeing by name with no seeing by meaning. He does not see. The all wise by name with no wisdom. Sami'un bila sam. Basirun bila basir, and so on. So that's why they are called the female. I don't know, because the female yani have some kind of flexibility, you know, something like this. Maybe. Something like this. Don't go too far.
Thank you.
Then the Sheikh says the third group are the Asha'ira. And Maturidiyya, Asha'ira and Maturidiyya. Asha'ira are the followers of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, who was a scholar, a Shafi'i scholar in the 4th century of Hijrah. And he is a descendant of the companion Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu. Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari himself has changed three times. First, he was Mu'tazila.
Then he met with Sheikh in his time, whose name was Ibn Kullab. And Ibn Kullab was replying on Mu'tazila in regards to their way of denying all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Kullab says that by logic, we must approve of some attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Allah is alive and he has a life, like Allah is able and he has an ability, like Allah is knowledgeable and he is not. So he approved of some of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when it came to most of the other attributes, he changed the meanings and he denied. So this was the way of Ibn Kullab. At least it was better than the Mu'tazila, who denied all attributes of Allah. So Al-Ash'ari liked this and he thought that this is the Sunnah. And therefore he started to reply on the Mu'tazila very strongly. And he became their enemy. He was speaking against them day and night. And he was very strong, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. Knowledgeable, strong in his expression. And then he met with Abu Zakaria al-Saji, one of the Hanbali Sunni scholars in his time. And Abu Zakaria al-Saji was on the way of the Salaf, on the way of the predecessors. And he was reading from the book of Sunnah by Imam Ahmad, Usul al-Sunnah or Sunnah by Imam Ahmad. So Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari listened very carefully, and after finishing, he came to him and he asked him the book. And he took it with him and he was convinced that this is the way, and he wrote some explanation of it, some defense for it. He wrote his book Al-Ibana an Usul al-Diyana, the clarification about the fundamentals of the religion. And then he declared openly in the masjid that he has left the way of Ibn Kullab, just like he has left the way of Mu'tazila. And he said, I have some books here in which I have refuted Ibn Kullab and I have refuted the Mu'tazila. And that book was Maqalat al-Islamiyyin. And he also gave the people the book of Ibana as an explanation of As-Sunnah by Imam Ahmad. In the beginning of Al-Ibana, he said, I am following the way of the great, honorable Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. I say that Allah has two hands because Allah said such and such. And he mentioned the verse regarding the two hands of Allah. And I say that Allah has two eyes because Allah said such and such. And he mentioned the verse. And I say that Allah is such a, and he mentioned all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the proofs. So this was Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari himself. So he is Salafi in regards to approving the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now those people who call themselves Ash'aris, they are not actually following the way of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari. They have two ways. One is the way of ta'wil, to alter the meanings, to say hands of Allah do not mean hands, but they mean ability, they mean favor, they mean this, they mean that. These are called Ahlul Ta'wil, the alteration of the meaning. Ta'wil is the alteration of the meaning in this. This is what they mean by ta'wil. And the second group of Ash'ariyah are Ahlul Tafwil, which we mentioned them earlier. The ones who say Allah has no hands, and the meaning here is not hands, but we do not assign any other meaning. We don't say hand means such and such. So they are the same as their other brothers, Ahlul Ta'wil. They are all called Mu'attilah. They have denied the true meaning. Ta'til is to deny the true meaning. This is Ta'til. Like a well which is emptied of water. بئر معطلة in Quran. Allah says بئر معطلة. Left. Has no water. Left. So when you take the word which contains the attribute of Allah and empty it from the meaning, you are committing ta'til. This word, hands of Allah, it is full. It is full with the meaning of the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great meaning. Hands which are expanded for people to repent. Hands which will be grabbing all heavens and earth on the day of judgment. Allah will put all the heavens and earth in his palm, in his hand. And it will be in his hand like a small mustard in your hand and my hand. So how could you dare to say that those two hands should be ignored? Who ignores such a great meaning but a fool? Who ignores such a great meaning but someone who is worth nothing? So that's why the predecessors became very angry when they heard such things. Because you are not speaking about humans, you are speaking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are you to say Allah has no hands, Allah has no face, Allah has no mercy, no true mercy, Allah does not love truly, Allah does not become angry truly? Who are you to say this? If one human being is told, you are as cold as an ice, you are as a wall, you don't feel happy, you don't love, you have no feeling, he will become very angry, right? He will become very angry. And he is only a human. How about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah loves, Allah hates, Allah is strong, Allah is mighty, Allah is merciful, Allah descends, Allah rose upon the throne, Allah is all hearing, He is all knowing. So these are the Asha'ira. The Maturidiyya are the same as Asha'ira in their way, but the Maturidiyya are related to Abu al-Mansur al-Maturidi. Maturidi, he was a scholar in what is now called India and those places near India. That time, in the 4th century of Hijra, it was called countries that are behind the river. Bilad ma wara al-nahar. That are further than the river. That was the expression they used to say about India and Pakistan and those countries. Bilad ma wara al-nahar. So Abu Mansur al-Maturidi was there, and he was giving da'wah there. And he took his madhab from Ibn Kulab, either directly or indirectly through some of his students. That's why Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari and al-Maturidi have almost, not 100%, but almost the same madhab in regards to attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the third category, al-Ash'ari and al-Maturidiyya and those who follow them. The Shaykh says, they approve of the names of Allah and some of the attributes. They approve of the names and some of the attributes. They deny the other attributes. And the misconception that made them fall into this is that creatures are described with such attributes, therefore we deny them, or we have to change the meaning. Yani they say since there is a common meaning, then it should be denied about Allah. Subhanallah. And you can very easily reply on those people, saying to them, why do you approve of the existence of Allah? Doesn't the creature exist? Right? They would have to say, no, if he does not exist, then we are atheists. We don't believe in this. Okay? We'll tell them, if you don't say he is merciful, then you are also, then you are the chicks of the atheists. You are the chicks. Sheikh Hamad al-Ansari, rahimahullah, used to say, Al-Mu'tazila and Jahmiya are the male and female. They are the parents. And the Ash'ariyah and Maturidiyah, they are firakh, chicks of those, chicks. So you are little Jahmis and little Mu'tazilas, small ones with nice looking feathers, innocent looking feathers, but you are actually saying mostly the same thing with some differences only. And then the Sheikh mentions what we just said, that they are either having ta'wil, altering the meanings of the hands of Allah, for example, or any other attribute, or they have tafweel, and that is to empty the meaning, altering the meanings or emptying the meaning from anything, and saying that we assign no meaning. Why didn't you say it from the beginning? Why did you say that Allah has no hands, or Allah has no true hands, and then you say, but we don't assign any meaning? If you are so pious, why didn't you become pious from the beginning and not say anything? And there is a madhab which is called al-waqifa, the stoppers, the ones who say, we just recite those verses and we say nothing. Just like reciting alif, lam, mim, alif, lam, ra. We recite them, they say, for barakah. We don't understand anything, we don't say anything, we don't say no true hands, we don't say true hands, we don't say anything. They are called al-waqifah, and they are innovators. But the tafweel is worse. Tafweel, because you are saying that it is not a true hand. The waqifah do not say it is not a true hand. But those people say it is not a true hand. And the Sheikh says, the first one who was known to deny the names and attributes were some pagans, idol worshippers in the Arabs, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about them in Quran, وَهُمْ يَكْفُرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَانِ, and they were denials of the all-beneficent, Ar-Rahman, verse 30, Surah Al-Ra'd. Of course, this verse was revealed as a reply and a refutation of the mushriks during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, O Allah, the most merciful, the most... They expressed denial of this. They expressed denial of this, even though they believed in attributes of Allah. They believed in the mercy of Allah. They did not deny that Allah is merciful. No. But they denied the name itself, Ar-Rahman. And then the Sheikh replies on them from many ways. The first, he says, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has approved for himself all those names and attributes, and that the messenger has approved them for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, to deny anything which Allah has approved about himself is a clear deviancy. It is a clear disobeying to Allah and his messenger. And the second point is that the fact that these attributes are also in the creatures does not mean that it should be denied, or they should be denied from Allah. You cannot deny the fact. You cannot deny the fact. If you are told the elephant has legs, you cannot say, no, I've seen an elephant. I haven't seen thighs like my thigh and foot like my foot. You cannot say this, right? And he's a creature like you. He has legs, but not like your legs. If someone tells you the fly has legs or the ant has legs, you cannot deny. It's been found, it's been proven that they have legs. The fact that their legs is different than yours doesn't mean you can deny them. And if you cannot deny some creature's attribute who is like you, or creatures like you, then how could you deny the attributes of the Creator? How could you deny that? You cannot deny it for creatures. How could you deny it for the Creator? How do you dare? When Allah says about Himself, I have two hands, how do you dare to say no, Allah? If we say you have two hands, then that means you have two hands like our hands, and we cannot accept this. How could you say this? This is a big يعني, slander, and it's daring. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about some of His creatures, Alim, knowledgeable. And He says in the other verse, Halim, passive, forgiving. And He says, we have created mankind and we have made him Sami'an Basira, hearing and seeing. And so on. So how could you deny what Allah says? But we know that the creature's hearing suits his position, suits his weakness. It's not the perfect hearing. It's not the perfect seeing. It is a temporary one. It's a weak one. It is subject to deficiencies. While Allah's hearing is most perfect, no deficiencies, all forever. The third way to reply them is to say, anyone who doesn't have attributes of perfection does not deserve to be God, does not deserve to be worshipped. That's why Ibrahim alayhi salam said to the mushriks when he saw them worshipping idols, how could you worship something which does not hear, which does not see, which does not know? How could you worship such a thing? So if you come now and say Allah does not hear, Allah does not, then you are going against the true nature, the true instinct. How could you be worshipping a God who has no attributes? How could you? As a matter of fact, there is nothing with no attributes except what? Except the non-existing things. What is it called? Non-existing. Non-existing. Nothing. Except nothing. You see? So the one who is worshipping an idol, even though he's kafir, but he is closer to faith than you. Because he is worshipping something and you are worshipping nothing. That's why the scholars say, المشبه يعبد صنما. Those who resemble Allah to His creatures, they are worshipping an idol. والمعطل يعبد عدما. And those who deny all the attributes of Allah, they are worshipping nothing. So something is better than nothing. Even though both of them are kufr, but at least this is closer, you know. And the fourth way to reply on those people is that approving of the attributes of Allah is perfection, and denying the attributes of Allah is deficiency. So the one who has no attributes is either non-existent or deficient. And Allah is most glorified of all this. And the fifth way is to say that changing the meaning of the attributes of Allah from the apparent meaning has no proof. No proof in Quran, no proof in Sunnah, no proof from the statements by the companions. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said to the Ash'aris who brought him to trial under one of their princes, he told them, I am going to give you 3 years. 3 years. See how much he was confident. To bring me any narration about any companion who changed the apparent meaning to some other meaning regarding the attributes of Allah. And he said, I give you 3 years to bring even a weak narration. A weak narration. Not very weak, not forged, because you can find forged. Forged, you can find everything. But he says, a weak narration. Bring it. True narration, I'm sure if I give you 100 years, you will not bring. But just a weak narration. 3 years. 3 years. Not 3 days. 3 years. He was very sure. And he was very sure because he was very knowledgeable. He said, I have read 100 books of tafsir. 100. So he was very sure. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he has not mentioned in his book anything that my attributes are not real, my attributes are not to be taken literally, my attributes should be changed and the meanings should be changed, nothing. As a matter of fact, he says, I am as-sami' al-basir, I am all hearing, all seeing. Okay, I created Adam with my hands. Okay, he told Musa, you are in my eyes. Huh? But now, when you recite those verses, that the hand of Allah is about their hands, or telling Musa, you are in my eyes, these are expressions which the Arabs have set them for a certain meaning. So the Ahlul Sunnah say, the fact that Allah mentions that he has eyes in this verse means that he has two eyes, truly. But when it comes to the whole statement, then we go to how the Arabs speak. And we say that, you are in my eyes means you will be protected by me. My hand is above your hands, I'm going to support you. You see? So Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah say that since Allah has attributed two hands to himself in this verse, then this must be true, because Allah knows himself better. Especially, he said in many other places that he has a right and a left, that he extends his hands, that he grabs with his hand, and so on. So this shows more proof that it is true hand. But not true hand means like our hands, because he is all different. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.